Yeah. Church. Happy to see all of you here today and all of those who are out there online watching us. Good morning, and if you are watching us online and you'd like to have a prayer request or anything, please put it in the comment area. Just a reminder, on the end of the pews is the red pew pad. Please sign that so we can kind of keep an idea of how many people are here in church today. The announcements for today are, there's a finance committee meeting at 6:30 in the Busy Bees Room on August the 12th. On Tuesday, August the 13th, the fourth day group will meet at 9 a.m. For those who don't know what that is, it is an Emmaus fourth day group. And if you want to know about Emmaus, or if you've been to Emmaus and done your walk, you're welcome to join in.
And that's at 9 o'clock at Tony's.
Yes, 9 o'clock at Tony's. Okay, Wednesday the 14th is prayer group at 10 o'clock on the stage. And there will be a new member class at 6:30 Wednesday evening in the Busy Bee Room. And then, of course, worship again next Sunday. Okay, endowment grant. If you have something that you'd like to apply for a grant for, they are taking requests. The applications are in the narthex, I believe. Is that right? Maybe in the narthex. Okay, so you can pick one up and have it filled out, and it must be turned in by the 15th of September. Last and not least, as there's all kinds of lovely tomatoes in the bag, in the narthex, that Jim and Carly Darling brought from their plentiful garden, and please help yourself. Anything else? Okay. Would you join me? Stand and join me to the call to worship. Lord, we watch and wait for you as the watchman waits in the morning light.
We are the people who live in great darkness.
We live in fear of everything that we cannot see and understand.
But we have appreciation, for we know salvation comes from the Lord.
Let us draw near.
And then we shall our Redeemer.
People who greet the morning, for in its light we see your glory. In the light, we see our Creator full of majesty. It is with a sense of awe and wonder that we gather here to greet you as your people. God, help us during this hour to be strengthened by your presence. Amen.
And I don't see the kids with us this morning, so we'll move forward. So we'll do our ministry of prayer. Microphone. There we go.
Just got news this morning that Velma's niece, whose name is Janelle, died about a week ago. I don't know the specific circumstances, but keep Velma and her family in prayer, and especially along with Velma, Janelle's mother, whose name is Gail. There will be a memorial held later, and I will share that information as I have it. one of her families of the plane crash overseas, there were 61 people all died. Christine in Florida at Dollar General in Winter Haven, many life struggles. A brother-in-law, Kevin, fighting infection in his toe and facing surgery. Families in Florida surviving the hurricane. Prayers for strength and wisdom. For the Ketch family who lost their dog, whose name was S'more. Prayers for a special friend and husband. A praise for a wonderful class reunion. Those are the ones we have to share together. I'll give you a moment to share those needs that are on your hearts but that you haven't shared with the congregation, and then I'll lead us in prayer. And Lord, your grace is new every morning. We have come to the space that we know as your house, and we thank you that you greet us here, greeting us with the gifts of your grace, your healing, your strength and your wisdom, hope and peace in your presence. We ask that you would speak to us this day as we need to hear you. Speak to us from your word as it is spoken. Speak to hearts and minds that need your healing and comfort and strength this day. Speak to us with joy for all you have in store for us in coming days and weeks and months. We do ask your healing presence to be with those who are grieving, like Velma's family, and especially Gail and the family of Janelle. For the families of those who were in the plane crash, for those like Christine in Florida who are struggling with all the things that life can throw at us. You know the specifics, and we know you're already at work, and for that we give you thanks. For Kevin, as he fights infection and faces surgery, work your healing touch in his body and use doctors as vessels of your healing work. For families affected by the hurricane, and we give thanks for the fact that that hurricane was not as severe as some that faced that area. And Lord, you know the need for strength and wisdom. We pray that the person or people who need that strength and wisdom in specific ways would know your touch, offering those gifts as you know they are needed. And Lord, we've asked a special presence for those who are grieving, and we have a family grieving the loss of a pet, and you know that animal lovers struggle with that loss, much like we do when human loved ones have passed. And Lord, these are the needs that hit closest to home for those who are gathered here this morning. We know that for each one of these, there are needs that have not been spoken, and we ask that you would touch those lives as well with your grace as it is needed. And we know that there are those needs around the country and around the world. Again, our political climate remains divisive, and we ask that you offer your peace in hearts and minds and decisions and relationships. And all of this we ask in the name of the one who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now let's stand once more and sing as we are able to stand. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel from all their iniquities. The word of God for the people of God.
Praise be to God.
A small Canadian deep sea submersible sank to the floor of the Irish Sea at a depth nearly 1,600 feet. Two men were inside the capsule, former British royal. Reading this, can't you just feel the air's going to run out? Most of the holes, pits, or depths where we find ourselves are not deep sea traps. Abandoned wells, sinkholes, or quicksand. Remember the TV shows that you always used to, you know, if you went out in the wilderness, got stuck in the woods, you could get stuck in quicksand and you couldn't get out by yourself. Most of our depths or holes are figurative and emotional, like relationship trouble, financial loss, grief, guilt, or scary medical diagnoses. But they can feel like being stuck in the depths of the sea, like these two men were. Whatever kind of depths we find ourselves in, there are at least four things we can do to help ourselves get out. First is stop digging. Makes sense, right? But don't we have a tendency to let panic, fear, anger, some kind of desperation keep us digging those holes a bit deeper all the time? Only stopping to get a bigger shovel? Emotional and relationship holes, bigger shovels might look like getting visibly angry, raising your voice, staying focused on the problem. Saying things to other people like, calm down. Does that ever work? Insisting on getting the last word. Correcting every minor detail in what someone else says or does. Digging our heels in, refusing to consider a different position than our own. Getting sarcastic. Or doing all of the talking rather than remembering to listen to whoever else might be involved. So if you're in the depths, stop digging and listen. Use I statements like I heard, I feel, I need. Try repeating what someone else says in your own words in order to be sure you understand. Be flexible and forgiving. Look for solutions. And second, don't dig a hole for others, pulling them into your own hole, putting them in a similar situation to where you are. Proverbs 26, verse 27, and Psalm 7, verse 15 make that point. Saying things like, don't lay traps for your enemies, you're likely to fall into the hole that you dig. You're causing yourself more trouble. Consider Haman, the villain in the story of Esther from the Old Testament. He died on the very gallows he had constructed for Esther's cousin Mordecai. And to watch a video of a play that was done at Sight and Sound Theater. Stop digging, whether it's a hole of your own or one for somebody else. And third, like David in Psalm 130, cry out for help. That can be hard for us to do since crying and asking for help are not necessarily tolerated by society, or at least in our heads, we feel like it might not be accepted. And when we feel like we're drowning, for example, whether that means something like drowning in debt, drowning in grief, drowning in things we need to do that we don't know where to start. The example is, if you feel like you're drowning, keep but also remember to stay out of God's path. If you, O Lord, something some co-worker said, if we cry out to God, God will forgive us and will save us from ourselves, healing our injured hearts so that we can work on our relationships, those relationships with ourselves, others, and also with God. Psalm 103, verse 12, says that when God forgives us, God removes our sin as far from us as the east is from the west. I found it interesting to learn that there is a difference between saying as the east is from the west versus as far as the north is from the south. And the difference, if we were to measure, may be the same. If you think about trying to walk due north or travel due north from where we are, and you're thinking you're going around the world, okay? But if you go north, you reach the North Pole at some point, and the only way you can go from there is south. So if you're going north, God has put your sins in the south, according to this image, you eventually are facing them again, right? You've been going north, you're going south, you're facing them again. But if you leave from this same place and figure you're going to travel around the world going due east of here, and your sins are in the west, you can go all the way around and you never go west again unless you turn around. Okay? Because if we keep going, you may be from the point where you started, you may be on the other side of the world going this way, but from that side of the world, that's still east. And you come back around. You never have to face them again unless you turn around. I found that an interesting distinction. So stop digging the hole, the one for yourself and any for others. Cry out to God. And fourth and finally, wait with hope, expecting God to respond to your prayers. You've called out to Him, expect Him to respond. Psalms 120 through 134, so of course including the one we've read for today, which was 130, are known as songs of ascents. Songs sung by worshipers as they went up to Jerusalem to attend maybe one of the three. And notice in the psalm that we read for this morning, notice that verse 6, the end of a night watchman's work. Morning, dawn is the time when he greets and debriefs those who will replace him on the day shift. He's off the clock in the morning and ready to rest. Also, morning brings relative safety from the kinds of trouble that are so prominent at night. So the night watchman waits with anticipation for the morning. If we wait for the Lord like a watchman waits for the morning, it's implied that we work like a watchman through our figurative and maybe spiritual sense of night. In our case, fighting sin, keeping an eye out for temptation, and warning others when we know of trouble. Waiting like a watchman. The line about waiting like the watchman waits for the morning in the middle. Let me go through how that chiasm works. The first four verses of Psalm 130 talk about repentance and forgiveness. David is asking for forgiveness for himself in those first four verses. Verse 5 talks about waiting and hoping. Again, it's David himself as an individual who is doing the waiting and hoping. And we get to verse 6, waiting like the watchman waits for the morning, and that line is repeated. Verse 7 goes back to waiting and hoping, this time corporate. It's the Israelites who are waiting and hoping. And again, the last line is, like the first, repentance and forgiveness. Again, the first line being, if you will, of the psalm, is repentance and forgiveness at the beginning and the end. The second line and the second to last are both waiting and hoping, and in the center is waiting like a watchman waits for the morning. While you wait for God to act in your situation, keep your thoughts in the present as much as possible. Rather than going over past mistakes and problems and thinking about what you would have, could have, should have done or said, focus on next steps and positive actions. When you're in the emotional depths, there's no way to go except up. So keep your focus in that direction. Wait with contentment. Practice peace. Waiting for God's help is like waiting for an elevator. Be ready to enter when the elevator arrives and the doors open. Be ready to act when God gives you an opportunity. But wait without pressing the button over and over. The elevator will get there when it gets there. And that's kind of the way God's help is too. God's help will come when we trust God's timing. Even from the deepest emotional depths, God hears us when we cry out to Him. Knowing this allows us to wait with not just hope, but even joyous expectation for what God has in store, believing that as bad as things might seem, something good is about to happen. Song, and so I have it for us to play this morning, and let's listen to "I Just Feel Like Something Good Is About to Happen."
Amen.
May they be the gift that someone in need receives and finds in these gifts.